गुड इवनिंग फ्रेंड्स, टुडे वी विल स्पीक अबाउट यूजर स्टोरीज। इन केस यू वांट टू डिस्कस अ पर्टिकुलर टॉपिक और यू वांट सम स्ट्रेस ऑन अ गिवन एरिया इन अ यूजर स्टोरी, प्लीज रेज अ क्वेश्चन। लाइक यू कैन सेंड मी अ मैसेज वाया क्वेश्चन बॉक्स एंड आई विल ट्राई टू फोकस मोर ऑन दोज पॉइंट्स विच यू कैन शेयर यूजिंग द क्वेश्चन बॉक्स। And in today's webinar, we will speak about what is user stories all about and card conversation and confirmation and the basic concepts of user stories, which is a tool for capturing and discussing requirements. I will take two, three logical break during the presentation, and during that break time, I will look at my question box and try to answer the queries raised by you. But as you get the query, you should write it and send it to me. So whenever I take a break, I can just look at the pending queries and I can reply to them. So now, so I am Saket. I have a company which is named like EigenBridge Consultancy Private Limited, and we provide agile training, especially PMI ACP certification program training online and face to face. In say face to face training, we are conducting as of now in Delhi and Hyderabad, and online platform is available for anyone who wants to learn about PMI ACP. So this is an agenda for the day. We will talk about user stories. We will discuss about epics and themes. So user story, there are two terms which come frequently in a user stories. One is a user story itself, and then there is a epics stories, and there are themes. So we will talk about what is epic and what is theme. And we will also talk about a characteristics of a good user story. Now, what is user story? User story is a smallest unit of a functionality which adds value to the user or purchaser. Now, user story describes a functionality which is either valuable to the user, application user, or the purchaser. It's a small unit. It's a small functionality which can give a value to the user or purchaser. So now, purchaser and user could be the same in some cases, and they could be different. For example, if we are using some online banking platform and our bank is providing that platform to us, so we are the user of that platform and that bank is a purchaser of it. So user story will cover the functionality or the features which are needed by the bank, and the user story should also cover the features which are needed by we as an end user. So user story describes the functionality that will give a value to either user or purchaser. Now, user stories are not describing a functionality which gives a direction to a developer. Like, the user stories are not a technical task, but they are a smallest unit which gives a value to the user and purchaser. Now, lot of time we start relating user stories with a traditional requirement document. Sometimes we think that user story is just a way of capturing requirement in agile project. We think that at the place traditionally we have been writing system specification document, and after that we came to know about RUP, and lot of us started writing use cases, and now this is something new, and this user story gives us a framework or a template, and in agile project we should write in that particular format. It is not the case. User story is not a requirement document. Now, user story is a tool which helps us in capturing the requirement via conversation. Now, user story emphasizes the verbal communication between the person who is providing the requirement and the person who is developing the requirement. So it's a communication tool between a product owner and the team. Since it is a very small set unit of functionality, it's like a small slice of the functionality, it is a very right size for the planning. Traditionally, when we write a use case, sometimes we write a very big use cases, and system specification document is always big. So if we use a use case or a system specification documentation based approach, our plan unit becomes bigger. Since user stories are slice of the functionality, they help us in planning well. Now, when we talk about user stories, there are three Cs. So cart, conversation, and confirmation. User story traditionally have been written on a note card. Nowadays people do use the electronic formats, like some use Rally, somebody is using Team Foundation, somebody is using Mingle, etc., etc. So you can use electronic or a tools to write a user story. But traditionally, user story is a card, which is like a 3 to 3 by 5 inch card, which can come in your pocket, and it's a reminder for a conversation. The card is a note card where you write a top level detail of the functionality which you want into the system, and it's a reminder to have a conversation when you want to get into the detail of that particular requirement. So the user story starts with a card where you write a small note on that particular card, and once that particular story gets scheduled for the development, you have a conversation. Now, the conversation between a product owner and a developer is a requirement capturing exercise. Now, requirement, rather than documenting the detailed requirement, we capture the requirement in conversation. We discuss the details of expected behavior of a user story of that particular functionality, and those conversation get captured or get translated at a summary level confirmation test cases. So we have a card which is a reminder for a discussion, and on the basis of that card, we have a conversation between the person who is giving a requirement and the person who is developing the requirement. And the summary, the business validations of that particular discussion, we write in the form of acceptance test cases, and they act like a condition of satisfaction. So it is like the product owner will get satisfied when these confirmation test points are getting executed well by the developed code. So they work as a confirmation tool for the user story. So you start with a requirement which is written on a top level requirement which is written on the card. You discuss the requirement details via conversation, and then you summarize that discussion in the form of validation point, and that is called your acceptance test cases. Now, this is a some like standard format sometimes get recommended that you should write user story in a format of as a role. I want to do something so that I get this benefit. Now, if you focus on this particular format, you will see that it is talking about three W's. One is who wants to use it, what they want to do it, and why they want to do it. So who is the one who is expecting this feature or functionality? What is that particular feature and why he needs it? So this particular format helps us in visualizing the goal of the user or a purchaser, which is who is asking for that particular slice of the functionality. So it's good to write a user story in a format as a role, user role. For example, as a job seeker, I want to search a job, I want to do something so that I can apply for it. Now, since when I was making my online test preparation site, so I was thinking about user story for my own site, and I made some sample user stories like this. So if this is a test preparation site, like PMI ACP test preparation simulation site, and here these are my sample stories for that particular site. As a student, I want to take a practice test so that I know my readiness for the exam. Okay, now here we have a sample user stories which I prepared for my test preparation site. So I spoke about as a user, I want to take a practice test so that I know my readiness for an exam. The second story is as an exam administrator, I should be able to publish new exams so that test taker can take it. So these are some sample stories where I am talking from a student point of view. Sometime I am talking about the other stories talking from an exam administrator point of view. So these are the cards which need to be discussed when we have a write responsible movement and we capture the details. Now, where are the details? So if I talk about as a student, I want to take a practice test so that I know my readiness for an exam. Now you may think the You may think that where are the details? Some questions which are like, does system allow user to select a number of questions? Do you have a feature where user can select resume and continue test? Like, can the user take the test in multiple sessions? Does system provide a facility to time the exam? Is it configurable? Can I configure that I want to do this particular test in 100 minutes or 120 minutes? Do I need to save the history data? Do I need to save the test data so that I can verify it at a later stage? So these details should be discussed with the person who is giving you a requirement, and once you have a discussion, they need to be converted into the condition of satisfaction. So you had a discussion, the product owner explained you, yes, you should have an option to configure the number of questions. You should have an option where the student can take this test into a multiple session. You should have a way where you can verify the result of your test at a later stage. So the summary of a discussions has been converted into a condition of satisfaction, or in a format of test points, like verify that test taken can select questions in the multiple of 10 with a maximum limit of 100. So you had a requirement, you had a card, you had the conversation, and then on the summary of that conversation, you converted in the form of acceptance criteria. And that also works as a condition of satisfaction. And these are the points which needs to be passed. Like, these are the test points which needs to be done before the developer comes to the product owner for saying that my work is done. So they work for a product owner point of view, they become like condition of satisfaction. Till the time these are not done, product owner will not satisfy with this particular user story. Now, sometimes you find that these acceptance test cases are good. You started with the user story, but the story is too big. It cannot be implemented into a one iteration. Now, the details can also be added in the form of sub-stories. So you started with a big story that as a student, I want to take a practice test so that I know my readiness for an exam. And you realize that this story is too big. You split this, you have split this particular story into a smaller stories. Like, there could be a one story which talks about taking a test with a predefined number of questions. Like, you have a fixed test, like it always give you 30 questions. Then you have another story which talks about the user configurable number of questions. Then you can have another story which talks about resuming and holding the test. So now you can have a different prioritization also. You may go with your normal story where everything is predetermined first, and later on you add the other features like holding and resuming the test and or reviewing the test results. Now, let us take a break here and let us take the questions. You can write the questions and I will try to address them. Okay, now let me see the questions here. Okay, so sound issue is done. I think we can hear now. We can't hear you. It's done, I guess. Now, in a financial organization, every requirements are documented mainly for the audit purpose. How this can be covered in agile approach? That's the first. That's the one question which we will discuss. Another one is condition of satisfaction, which are acceptance criteria. I understand more detailed requirements are captured later during the implementation. Question: when and how the detail of look and feel of GUI discussed, when and how the details of validation discussed, and when and how the details are documented. Okay, so now take one by one. Say, if you have a compliance requirement, if you are the industry you are working in requires you to produce evidence of your requirement details, then you may need to substantiate the document, your product development process, with documentation. Say, Scrum or Agile is not something which are very against the documentation. Scrum and Agile always talks about that we should have a bare minimal documentation. So we focus, our value is that we have a working software rather than having a detailed documentation. But if you have an auditory responsibility, if you are working into a health domain, if you are working into some compliance related domain, you may need to document the things which are required by your compliant or regulatory body. Now, even if you are not working in a compliance or that kind of environment, still sometime you may need to document your requirement if you cannot capture the requirement via conversation. If your product owner or if the person who is giving you a requirement is not available to you, then you may need to fall back on detailed documentation. So the point is, the detailed documentation will happen somewhere else, not in a user story card. You can refer that document into a user story card, but the user story card is not meant for capturing the detailed documentation. For example, if you have a complex tax calculation rule, if you have insurance calculation rules, which are predetermined by the regulatory body, those all documents can be referred in a user story card. Now, when do we when do we discuss GUI? How do we talk about how the complete system will look like? This was another question. And when we will discuss what kind of validations we need to put. Now, say if we are working into a software, into a close coordination, we may have a template for, we may have an agreed understanding of what and how our GUIs looks like. And still we can have a wireframe diagrams which can explain the expectation of rough GUI to the developers. So now you can refer those wireframe diagrams in your user story card. You can keep them separately, or you can discuss it over the board and wipe it out. Now, sometimes it happens that we do not have evidence of it. Like you had some discussion with your product owner, and once you are done with it, you find that you are helpless because product owner is changing requirement and you don't have any document to fall back on. Now, user stories work good if the time difference between a discussion and a product development is less. Like if you're discussing something today, and if you develop that feature in next 3-4 days, and you demonstrate that feature on the 4th or 5th day to your product owner or to the customer, then these kind of confusions can be removed. Like then there will be a good amount of trust, because whatever I'm saying today, I'm getting that thing back in 3-4 days. And once I accept that story, the working software is the only thing which I need to refer to, not the story card. Now, the detailed look and feel can be discussed. We can use the templates of GUIs that this is how our application looks like, and we can also create a wireframes if required. Now, validations. So business validations are captured in the form of acceptance criteria, but you may have a detailed validations related to negative cases. For example, if you have a text box, you may have a requirement that this text box should not be taking more than 100 characters. If you have a date field, you may have a condition that it should not be taking 30th February as an input. So these all things should be also governed by a standard test cases. Now, you may have a checklist. The developer may have a rule book talking about their way of coding, where they need to perform all these tests. You may automate them to all the user stories. So the acceptance test criteria should not be including engineering or regression testing or boundary condition type of test cases. The acceptance criteria only include the test cases which are focusing on business values. Now, there are various things like how do you talk about which message should come, how do you talk about which particular title will work for a particular column, and lot of time traditionally we spend significant amount of time talking about these small things. Now, here it is ideally, we should work in a format where everybody understands how the screen needs to be designed. If we have a confusion, we have a collaborative discussion with the product owner and we move forward. Now, Agile and Scrum does not have any specific requirement of documentation, but it is clear that user story is not a instrument for capturing the detail requirement. User story is a conversation, is a facilitation instrument which helps you capturing the requirement via conversation. And if you cannot capture the requirement via conversation, then you may need to fall back on traditional way of documenting the requirement and moving forward. Any other question? Estimating of the days for requirement capturing. Now, how do we estimate the days for the requirement capturing? Now, how these agile or a traditional scrum projects works? We start with a one product backlog. Now, from where the product backlog come? Now, that should have been prepared before we start executing sprint one. So we may, if we are just going with a very new product, we may have a sprint zero, where we create a top level product backlog. And that is something which we can do if we are working with a very new product development. And in that particular sprint zero, we may have most of the user stories at epic level, but some of the user stories which are expected to get executed in an upcoming sprint should be at a slice level. Now, what is that slice level? We will talk in a subsequent part of this presentation. Now, if we are following a new product development and release process, this the release level product backlog should be estimated in sprint zero and iteration zero. So we should play a planning poker where we get a release level sizing of our complete product backlog. Now there is another question, like I have a team of 3 members and I want to calculate the velocity and capacity of a team to plan sprint deliverables. How we should do that? Now, it's a planning, like release planning question, like how do we estimate or calculate the velocity? Now, if we if we talk about Scrum theories or Agile theories and Mike Cohen's theories, we have a 3 ways of identifying or estimating velocity. First, if you have a sample historical data, like if you have, this team has been working, this team of three, now team of three is less than the Scrum required team size. So you should have a 5 to 9. So it is, now if you have a sprint Scrum team, so I am assuming the team size is between 5 to 9, and that's, if you have a historical velocity information available for the team, you use that velocity. If you don't, then the second option could be that you run a few of the sprint and a few like practice or experimental sprints, and then you drive the velocity on the basis of experience in those sprints. If that is also not possible, you need to start with some kind of planning, then you need to estimate the velocity. Now, how the estimation can be done? Estimation can be done by way of traditional approach, where we calculate that total number of hours available in your team, and then we convert those hours by using some factor. That's a, this is a one way of estimating, by some factor into an ideal hours, that okay, if I have 200 hours of time available, I may convert this 200 into a 120 ideal hours, and then I may break some of my sample user stories into ideal hours, and then I compare. So I drive a velocity for initial to, for an estimation purpose, and once I have a data, once I run 2-3 sprints, then I know what is my real velocity, and I adjust my velocity for the rest of my time. Now, during a sprint zero, we do not estimate the duration. We estimate the size, and as the next, like the previous question I was talking about, on the basis of velocity, which is like a velocity is a team rate of converting size into a potential shippable product. So on the basis of team rate, on the basis of velocity and my size, we calculate the duration. Now, if your application is too sensitive to graphics user interface. Like you want to have very user friendly interfaces, you want to have a predictive text, etc., etc. Your complete the velocity will take into account, like velocity would be low, because against the application where you are not much focusing on performance or usability of the application, and there is another application where you are too much concerned about the usability and performance, the velocity would be less because you are applying more constraints to it. So we do estimate in a form of velocity, but we don't estimate the product backlog in form of hours in a sprint zero. So the sprint zero estimation is a guiding estimation. It's a rough order of magnitude estimation, be it traditional project management, be it agile project management. Whatever you are doing in the beginning of the project will always remain rough order of magnitude. So you can expect plus minus 30 to 50% of variance, whatever you estimate in your sprint zero, whatever you estimate in your traditional projects during RFP phase or during project initiation phase. So you, the initial estimate which you do during your release, like iteration zero or at the time of your release planning, is a guiding factor for the rest of the duration, but it is not something which is achievable. It is the cone of uncertainty which we talks about traditionally as well as in agile is always there. As much we know about the system, we can project it. As we move forward, we will uncover more about, we will explore more about the system, our team and productivity, and that is how we move. Okay, any other before I move? Okay, we are doing good. We are on time. And if I get disconnected, please don't panic. The connection will restore within 1 or 2 minutes. There's some issue in connection, so sometime it get disconnected. Okay, now let's move to our second agenda item. Now, epics and themes. When we start with our this cone, this triangle is representing a product backlog. So it has a small slice of requirement at the top of it. So the size of these rectangles, this small box, represents the size of user story. So at the top of your product backlog, you have a small sized user stories. At the bottom of your product backlog, you have a big size user epics. Now, why epics and what they are? As I spoke about my previous example, initially when you are planning for your product backlog, you may have epics, a big epics in your system. Now, epics are the user stories which are at a higher level. We spoke about, like, as a student, I want to take a practice test so that I can measure my a performance. So it's a big epic because it involves multiple functionalities which cannot be developed in one iteration. But if we are not planning this particular set of functionality in next 2-3 iterations, we may keep this at an epic level only. So epic is a big story which we create at the initial stage of our development or thought process. And since these stories are not near to their development, they remain at a big size, and once they come to their development life cycle, they will get sliced into a smaller stories. So we start in general, we usually identify epics first, and then we break epics into a small user stories. Now, once we have a collection of user stories, we started with epics, we made some small user stories, and now we have a good bunch of user stories. Now, once we have this small set of user stories, we want to group them again so that we can treat them as a single entity for communication, sometime even in estimation, for communicating a logical performance status of your project. And that grouping is called theme. So first you had a small stories, and when you group those small stories into a one unit, into a one logical group, they all called theme. So we do not have a relationship between, like, there will be a theme, then there will be an epic, then there will be a user story. or there will be an epic first, then the theme, and then the user story. Epic and user story does have a relationship. Epic is a big compound user stories which get disaggregated into a small slice, small user stories. But theme is a group of these small user stories which represent the related functionality. Now, some comparisons, some more information on it. Epics are like a placeholder, while theme are as a group that they group the set of related stories. Now, epics is something which is top down. We start thinking at a top and then we slice the user stories as we move forward. We progressively elaborate. It's a manifestation or it's the implementation of progressive elaboration. So we move forward, we elaborate the epic story progressively. Themes are like bottom up. You have a progressively elaborated small slice of the stories. Now you group them together and you create theme out of it. There is no hierarchical relationship between theme and epic. Epics are usually bigger than theme, but the reverse can also happen. It is possible that you have a bigger theme which is composite of multiple epics. Now, another example for an epic which is coming out of a job site. So, if you have a story, as a job seeker, I should be able to search for a job so that I can find a suitable job. So, this looks like a big goal and kind of a main story of any job site. Because job site should provide a feature where job seeker can come and search for a suitable match. Now, this is too big for implementation. So what we can do, we can slice it and say, as a job seeker, I should be able to search for a job by keywords and location, or maybe a keyword, one story, location, another story, so that I can find a suitable match. There could be another story which talks about, as a job seeker, I should be able to search for a job by a salary range so that I can find a suitable match. So we started with a big goal. Okay, in my application, I should have a facility where I provide the searching feature to my end user. But this feature looks too big. So let us slice it. And these are the ways of slicing it. Now, it's not necessary. It's not always necessary to get a small slice of user story at a one level. Now, you may have 2-3 levels of epic before you reach to a small size. Slice. Now, in this particular example, we talk about that we started with a goal, like you are a project management office head and you want to review the performance of all ongoing projects. So your goal is that I want to review the performance of all ongoing projects so that I can take a corrective actions. Now, it looks like that giving a performance of a complete project into a one story is difficult. Then you split it up from various constraints. You say, okay, I will give a one feature which talks about time related performance, another feature which talks about a budget related performance. So we split the story between time and budget. He says that as a PMO head, I would like to review project performance against time so that I can take corrective action. Now, time is itself is again very big. Then further, this time user story will may get splitted under I want to see the upcoming milestones. I want to see which all milestones got missed, etc., etc. So now you started with a big goal, then you split that big goal into two smaller goals, but they still looks like an epic. They cannot be developed into a one iteration. Then you need to go at a further level. And you may have 2-3 levels of slicing before you reach to a invest story. So what is invest story? That will come. So a story which is good for a development. Now, what are the way of splitting the story? Now, we should not be doing a technical division of the story. We should slice the cake on the basis of requirement. So we always use the term slice the cake. So what does it mean, the slice the cake? The slice of the cake should have a complete taste of the cake. So the person who is consuming that slice is getting the complete taste of the cake, but he is only getting the slice. The technical division would be that he is only getting the flour, egg and sugar separately. So he is not getting the taste of a cake. So technical division is something which is not meeting the user goal. Like you divide the as a job seeker can post a resume. So I had a user story that as a job seeker, I should be able to post a resume. And you divided technically that story in a way, as a job seeker, I can fill out a resume form. So now I just have filled a resume form because I only want to make GUI of it. I don't want to make a save functionality as of now. And then you created another user story that information which are filled in the form can be written into a database. So now the problem with this division is that they are not giving a functionality to the end user. They are not slice. They are only a flow or an egg. The other way of doing it, if we say a slice of the cake, as a job seeker, I can submit a resume that include only basic information such as name, address, education history, etc. And there could be another story which talks about, as a job seeker, I can submit more information related to like my past employment, skills, etc., etc. So you can have this kind of division where the slicing is happening and end user is also getting some value out of it. Now, there are two types of epic. One is a compound story and another is a complex story. So epic can be categorized broadly in two types. Compound stories are the type of epic which are like an aggregation of multiple small requirements. The one which we discussed till now were all compound stories. Now there could be another type of epic which is called a complex story. The complex story is not a big requirement, but since because of technology involved, it is inherently large. You cannot split into a small functional user stories, but it takes more time to develop it. Because, for example, you are doing first time integration with geospatial data and you don't know about geospatial data. So first time integration will take a significant amount of time, and which cannot be further splitted, because you just need to pick a geospatial information of your customer and show it at your web page. Now, the story which are of compound type, the one which we discussed till now, can be sliced by applying various methods. And you can use a combination of these methods. These are not mutually exclusive methods. They can work with each other. The first method could be, we split across the data boundaries, as I spoke about. We give a selective filled information first. We say that initially you have a general information, then you move further. There could be a second way of splitting is that we do on operational boundaries. Like we only provide add features, then we add the edit features, etc., create features, delete features. Then there could be a third where we remove a cross-cutting concerns. Like you may have a rule that every story should be logging some exception information. It should be logging some audit information. If you find the story is too big, you may decide that audit and logging can be done in a separate story. First, we do a story where we do not log or we do not store the auditing information. The fourth possible way of splitting slicing the compound story is that you don't meet performance constraints. Like you may have a performance constraint which talks about that response time should not be more than 30 seconds in any user story or in any functionality. But if you find that my search work is becoming too much, so for a time I want to separate the performance from a functionality, you may create two stories, one story without meeting the performance criteria, the next story with the performance criteria. So that's a one way of slicing it. And the other way of slicing it, that you, if you have a story which is having acceptance criteria which are of multiple priority or different priorities. For example, you had a story that I want to search a job via using keyword and location, and you identified that keyword and location has a very different priority. You identified that 90% of the people who are searching for the job are searching based on keywords. So since only 10% people are searching by the location, it's better to slice them separately. So you can have a better prioritizations on the basis of the priority of functionality. Now, unlike compound stories, complex stories are technical in nature. They cannot be sliced by functionality point of view. So you can divide these technical stories into two categories by separating investigation from development. So you may create a spike story which are time boxed, which talks about just investigating the issues which are involved in that complex story. For example, if we are talking about geospatial integration, we may have some investigation, some time boxed, like POC, you can say proof of concept stories, where you just analyzed how this geospatial data works, how it gets stored, and once you get a good understanding of that particular technology, then you estimate the development story and you do it in a one iteration. Okay, we take a small Q&A break. There was a previous questions which was talking about that we don't speak about look and feel and validation in sprint zero. So how to estimate during sprint? I think we discussed it. So do we have a question on this Apex themes and slicing before we take the final agenda item? Now see, the compound story is an epic. So we start our thought process by visualizing the big requirement, which is a compound story. Theme is that once we have a good amount of small user stories, now we want to do a reverse engineering. We want to group them to make a logical grouping, logical communication. For example, like when we were talking about login, we were talking about authentication, we were talking about that the system should be secure enough that if some person tries to log or hack the system should be able to protect it. So that is some security we spoke about when we were talking about a login related user stories. Then when we went into the search, when we went into a profile creation, there also we spoke about some of the security features which protects one user getting into somebody else's profile. So at a different stages, when we were splitting the epic into a small stories, we created many stories which were related to security of the system. Now these small stories can be grouped together into a theme called security. So when we want to communicate about the progress related to security theme, they help us in visualizing that these all stories are which are falling under security. But while we started thinking about our requirement, we could not make a one user story which says that system should be secure, and then we split it all this into a different behavior. We started with the functional stories, and then we added security stories in all those epics, and finally we found that okay, they can be grouped under theme, and the theme is in another dimension. So you have now that's a way compound story make us think about a breaking up. It is like a top down approach. We think of a top requirement, and then we break into a small disaggregate them. And theme is reverse, like we have a disaggregate component and we aggregate them for a management and communication purpose. That is well said, Mohammed. So it is that. Okay, should I proceed because we are just 12 minutes behind our, I think. Okay, let's start with the fourth agenda item. And in case if you have a questions, please keep typing them. So I will take it at the end of the presentation. So now the final agenda item, which talks about a good user story. So good user story should be an invest story. The people that attendees who are thinking of appearing from PMI ACT exam should remember invest. There is a very high probability that you will get at least one question talking about just the full form of invest or talking about a particular character of this invest. Now, what is invest? The user story should be independent, negotiable, valuable to user or customer, should be estimatable, should be small enough to give you a right size for planning, and should be testable. Now, the good user story, the stories which are at the top of product backlog should be invest stories. The stories which are getting developed in our upcoming iteration should be at invest, should be of invest type. They should be independent. Now, we should avoid introducing dependencies between stories. Now, sometimes it is not always possible, but we should write the user story. We should always focus on creating a stories which are independent from one another. You may have a normal order of execution. For example, in order to search the job, you must have the job ready. But it's not necessary that you create those jobs ready through implementing the create job user story. You may have a way of creating the data of those jobs if required. So you should try to have an independent user story. User stories are negotiable, so they are not baseline written contract. While you are discussing the user story, you have agreed on set of acceptance test criteria. But while developing, if you find that one criteria is taking too much time, you have a facility to negotiate with the product owner and he may agree to remove or create a separate story for that acceptance test criteria. A. The B is also possible. B is like you are done with your acceptance test criteria and you show that working software to your product owner and he says that this is good, but it's good if we add one more feature or one more acceptance test to it. And if you can do it without impacting your sprint goals, without impacting your sprint task or sprint backlog, so if it fits in your current sprint planning, you can implement it. So it's a negotiable instrument. The user stories are valuable to customer or user or purchaser. It should be estimatable. So it should be sized enough so you can estimate, because if it is too big, it's difficult to estimate epics. But we do estimate epics, but the small stories gives us a good accuracy level in against the estimated number. They should be small. They should be testable. Now, the good user story should be closed story. Rather than talking about a subjective way, like rather than talking about that the system should be user friendly, we should talk about what exactly performance expectation do we have, what exactly we want from the system. So it should be testable enough. Now, acceptance test cases are the confirmation criteria. They make the user story testable, but it's good if the user story at a description level, at a card level itself is testable. Now, a good user story should be a closed story. It should not be open-ended, same like any traditional requirement, should have user role. So rather than writing as a user I should be able to do it, we should be able to put a user role in that place. Say as a job seeker I should be able to do it, as a student I should be able to take an exam, rather than just talking about a simple user. Now the individual users who are using your applications are grouped into, are aggregated into user roles. So user story should have as a user role what I want to do it and why I want to do it. And it should not be focusing too much on user interface. Now, user interface should, ideally, you should have a template. You should have a clear understanding that how your UI should look like. But we should not spend too much time in just designing the UIs. You can work with wireframe diagrams, but user story should not be focusing. You should not be communicating or everything through UIs and should have acceptance tests attached to it. So this is the agenda for the day. We spoke about user stories, how they are different from traditional requirement document, a card, conversation and confirmation, how they facilitate the captioning of user requirement via conversation. We spoke about the difference between epics and theme, what is epic, what is theme, how they relate with each other, and what are the characteristics of a good user stories. So we do Scrum training, PMI ACP. I work with EigenBridge and we conduct all sort of things. I think most of you know that we have a good practice test and we are providing PMI ACP education, face-to-face training as well as online training. And these are my contact details. It would be a good idea if you join our LinkedIn community or a Facebook page, because we try to trigger various topics which are very relevant for PMI ACP exam in our LinkedIn group. So if you are not part of it, please be part of it. And if you are already part of it, then start commenting and take some participation. Okay, so final round of the questions. When do we do epic story and story sub-story? Now, the epic to a story. Now, everything in Agile, the question is that when do we divide epic to a stories or sub stories. So when do we disaggregate the epic into a small user stories? At the last responsible moment. Now, when that last responsible moment is, if we think that this epic needs to be implemented in next two or three sprints, then I as a product owner should split it into a small stories. Now, the team is working on their sprint. I have given them a priority for sprint one. Now, when they are working on sprint one, I, as a product owner, I am grooming a product backlog for future sprints. So when I am grooming the product backlog for future sprints, splitting the story into a smaller sub-story is a part of product backlog grooming. So I groom them, I split them, and I prioritize things as per the expected schedule in a development. Like I don't groom the story which I don't expect to get scheduled in a very long time. Now, sometime the question is that if we have a user story which is not adding value directly to the user or purchaser, it should be required for a product. Should it be discussed in the user story, or should it be included as an epic theme within the product backlog? Now, when we talk about Scrum, Scrum does not mandate you to only have a user story into a product backlog. You can have a user stories, you can have a technical depth items, you can have a bugs, defects in your product backlog. So if you have some non-functional, or if you have some non-user specific important items which are time consuming, which cannot be taken care just by following the rules, or which cannot be implemented just by following the constraint, you may need to size it and include it into your product backlog. Because in order to give a direction towards release planning, you should include into a product backlog, but that may not necessarily be written in the form of user stories, because these are the requirements which are not given by the product owner, and he is not going to verify it that this is done or this is not done. Now, there was a question which is talking about Skype question mark. So it is not Skype, it is a Spike. So Spike is a time boxed. Okay, I got the I don't have. Okay, we will talk. So the Spike is a time boxed user story, a time boxed technical story which we use to facilitate investigation of a technical issue. So once you have a complex story which you want to split into an investigation and development, and then we use Spike. Spike is a POC, it is an investigation story which is usually time boxed. Any other question? Okay, friends, thanks for joining in. And in case if you have a follow-up questions, please do post. You can email me, you can post your queries in a form of generic question in our LinkedIn forum or at our Facebook, because everybody can participate if you post these questions in a community. And in case you have a specific query related to this topic, you can email me. My contacts are available everywhere, so you know how to reach me.